الله الرحمن الرحيم. إن الحمد لله نحمده تعالى ونستهديه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا، إنه من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له، وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله. But let me of fiqh, and we were staying still with the praying in congregation of Salat al-Jama'ah, and we mentioned a lot about praying in congregation and the virtue, the reward for praying in congregation, and that it is a must for a healthy staying Muslim to pray in congregation and not in his house. And this is the sunnah of the Prophet ﷺ, to pay your praying in the masjid where you can meet your fellow Muslim brothers, stand in the line proper way, and like the angels stand, as in the hadith of the Prophet ﷺ, أَلَا تَصَافُونَ كَمَا تَصَافُ الْمَلَائِكَةُ عِنْدَ رَبِّهِمْ قَالُوا وَكَيْفَ تَصَافُ الْمَلَائِكَةُ عِنْدَ رَبِّهِمْ قال يصافون صلى الله عليه وسلم like wouldn't you stand like the angels stand at the heaven with where they are in the seventh heaven, and the Muslims, the companions of the Prophet, how do the angels stand like he says they stand straight leg by leg and line by line, no spaces or interventions between them. And this, the Prophet ﷺ used to face the Muslims during the Salah and say to them, "Istaqimu ya khawfullah," straight yourself, may Allah bless you. And he used to tell them as well, "Al-katifu bil-katif wal-qadamu bil-qadami," so you stop shoulder by shoulder, feet by feet. The line would be standing straight up, and he used to tell the Prophet ﷺ, to tell the companion radiallahu anhum, the Prophet ﷺ used to tell them, لَتُسَوُّنَّ بَيْنَ صُفُوفَكُمْ أَوْ لَيُخَالِفَنَّ اللَّهُ بَيْنَ قُلُوبِكُمْ. You would straighten up your line, or Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala would make your heart not alike, so that, meaning that using the proper way in the salah, standing beside one another in the salah, in the proper way in the line, make the heart closer together. As Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in Surah Al-Anfal, لَوْ أَنْفَقْتَ مَا فِي الْأَرْضِ جَمِيعًا مَا أَلَّفْتَ بَيْنَ قُلُوبَهُمْ وَلَكِنَّ اللَّهَ أَلَّفْتَ بَيْنَهُمْ. If you spend all the money upon the earth to make their hearts come together, you would not be able to do that. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make their hearts together to like one another. And this is the enforcement of the iman, the faith and the belief between the Muslim brothers. Now we come to another point. By the praying in congregation, and this was part among the last part of the Kitab al-Salah, is saying the earth as a mosque. Well, if a Muslim or a group of Muslims had a time for praying and they are not in the masjid where they can pray, there is no masjid, any masjid around where they can pray. Actually, this is a virtue for the Muslim, that the Prophet ﷺ told us that any Muslim catches the time of the prayer or calls by the time of the prayer at any time, فَمَعَهُ طَهُورُهُ وَصَلَاتُهُ. You have your own ablution, and you have your own place to pray. Tahuru is the earth, the face of the earth. If a Muslim did not find water to make wudu, he can simply strike on the sand upon the surface of the earth and wiped his hand, and another tried and wiped his face, and this is called at-tayammum. And this is enough to be in a tahur state so that you can go into the salah. And then, if you cannot find a masjid to pray, you can simply pray anywhere on the earth. Any place you can pray in. Save the only place that you cannot pray in is the toilet and the cemetery. Yes. You cannot pray in a cemetery or in a toilet, because these are not the proper places to mention Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in. But and you can pray anywhere. جُعِلَتْ لِيَ الْأَرْضُ مَسْجِدًا وَطَهُورًا فَأَيُّمَا رَجُلٌ مِّنْ أُمَّتِي أَدْرَكَتْهُ الصَّلَاةِ فَلْيُصَلِّي. The earth has been made to me and my nation a masjid and a tahur. So any person has the salah at any time, he can simply pray anywhere. And this hadith is related by Abu Dharr radiallahu anhu. Then comes to the essence of building mosques. What is the reward and the virtue of building masajid or mosques? Uthman told the Prophet وسلم, said, whoever builds for Allah a mosque, seeking by it Allah's grace, Allah will build for him a house in paradise. And this is related by Al-Bukhari and Muslim. So, Uthman radiallahu anhu, may Allah be pleased with him, reports that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, peace and blessing be upon him, says, whoever builds for Allah a mosque or a masjid, seeking by it Allah's grace. So this is an important point. You should watch your intention, as we mentioned, that many people do a lot of actions, but they are not rewarded for, because they did not seek in the first place the blessing of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. They did so and so for their own sake, or for someone else's sake, or for some materialistic thing in the life, so they are not going to be rewarded for that in the thereafter. They might be rewarded for that in this dunya, upon the earth, but not at the paradise. Because of the hadith al-Qudsi, where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, أَنَا أَغْنَى الشُّرَكَاءُ عَنِ الشِّرْكِ مَنْ عَمِلَ عَمَلًا أَشْرَكَ فِيهِ مَعِيَ غَيْرِي تَرَكْتُهُ وَشِرْكُهُ. I am, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala saying, I am the most not in need for associating partners. Whoever did any type of work or deed, and he associated partner with me in his intention, I would leave his work for his partner. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala would not accept unless what is totally pure, 100% pure for Allah. You cannot pray for Allah and for people to say he's a good man, he's praying. You cannot give alms or charity money for Allah and to be said that you are generous. Okay, you cannot help someone to be a kind person or to get a degree in the life, in this life. Well, if you did so, you'll be rewarded for it in this life. But then, when you meet Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you have nothing, because you have had your reward in the dunya, so it wouldn't be in the akhirah. That's why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the hadith of the Prophet is saying, seeking by it Allah's grace. Allah will build for him a house in paradise. And you can just imagine the difference between building a building or a house in or a masjid in the earth and another one in the Ramadan, where ما لا عين رأت ولا أذن سمعت ولا خطر على قلب بشر, not have been seen by an eye, heard by an ear, or even passed by the mind of a human being. Because it's all what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala had hidden for his proper believers. In another hadith reported by Ibn Abbas radiallahu anhu, that the Prophet said, whoever bids for Allah a mosque, even if it is tiny, in some ways of that hadith, وَلَوْ كَمِسْحَصِ قِطَاءٍ. You know, مِسْحَصُ قِطَاءٍ is the place that a cat would put her, you know, children in. Just a very tiny place. Even if you build a masjid, just a very small place, so that just them the Muslims can pray even in a one row in a tight area, even if it's such way, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala would build for you a house in the Ramadan. Allah will build for him a house in the Ramadan. Now we come to another point, which is supplication while going to the masjid. As we mentioned earlier, the easiest type of worshipping Allah is a dhikr. Yes, exactly, is remembrance of Allah. Because you can do it any time, any place, any situation. I mean, you can make dhikr, remembrance of Allah, while you are in an ablution state or not, while you're praying or not, while you're staying or standing or sitting or even lying down. You can make dhikr while you're doing anything else. Say, if you are in the toilet, of course, you cannot remember Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the toilet because it's not the proper place. But anything else, you can make dhikr. Actually, we've been told the type of adhkar or the remembrance of Allah for every single action of our life. When you woke up from bed, you would say, Alhamdulillah, alladhi ahyana ba'dana amatana wa ilayhi nushur. When you dress or undress, you would remember Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. When you make your ablution, when you go to the toilet, when you go out of the toilet, when you eat or drink, when you finish eating or drinking, when you even come to your wife in a sexual intercourse, you would say, Allahumma jannibna shaytan wa jannib shaytan ma razaqtana. May Allah keep the shaytan, keep the devil away from us, and keep the devil away from what you have given to us, if there is a lady to come from that. When you go to the masjid, when you go out of your house, you say, Bismillah, tawakkalna ala Allah, wa la hawla wa la quwwata illa billah, in the name of Allah, I depend and rely on Allah, and I have no power or way or maneuver except by the power and the maneuver of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So that you're just saying that you're helpless without God, your nourisher and creator. Then when you go to the masjid, when you move to the masjid, you would say, Allahumma ja'al fi qalbi nura, wa fi lisani nura, wa fi sam'i nura, wa fi basari nura. Allahumma a'tini nura. In some ways of the hadith, وَاجْعَلْ مِنْ أَمَامِي نُورًا وَمِنْ قَلْبِي نُورًا وَعَنْ يَمِينِي نُورًا وَعَنْ شِمَالِي نُورًا اللَّهُمَّ اجْعَلْ لِي نُورًا. O Allah, my Lord, made light in my heart, light in my hearing, light in my sight, light in my tongue and my tooth, light in front of me, light behind me, light on the right side and light on the left side. Allahumma ij'al li nura, O my Lord, give me light. Of course, the light does not mean a lamp light or even a sun light, but it means the light of the guidance. As Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَمَنْ لَمْ يَجْعَلِ اللَّهُ لَهُ نُورٌ فَلَا لَهُ نُورٌ. Whoever that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala did not give him a light, he wouldn't have a light. Even if he in a 1 mega lamp illumination, he has darkness in his soul. So the light is the light of guidance. And this is particularly mentioned when you go to the prayers in the masjid on dark times, like in Fajr prayer, in Isha prayer. As the Hadith of the Prophet ﷺ says, بَشِّرْ الْمَشَّاءُونَ لِلْمَسَاجِدِ فِي الظُّلَمْ بِالنُّورِ التَّامِ يَوْمَ الْقِيَامَةِ. May you give the glad tidings to those who walk to the masjid in darkness by the complete light and the complete lightness in the day of resurrection. You know, in the day of resurrection, there would be the sirat, and the sirat is the path that you would pass over from the place where the people are standing to be held accounted for their deeds in this life. And if they are able to pass over this path, they would go to the paradise on the other side. And if they fell from that path, they would fall in the hellfire. That path is so thin like a hair, so sharp like a knife, and totally dark. And you have no source of illumination of light except your deed. And that's why, according to everyone's deed, he would have a light. The light can be like from his face and head and body, illuminating all his way, so he can go away straight ahead like wind. And his light can be as little as a tip of his finger that illuminates and shuts down. Illuminates and shuts down. That's the meaning of the verse in the Quran where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, إِذْ يَقُولُ الْمُنَافِقُونَ وَالَّذِينَ فِي قُلُوبِهِمْ مَرَضٌ لِلَّذِينَ آمَنُوا أُنْظُرُونَا نَقْتَبِسُ مِنْ نُورِكُمْ. Where the hypocrites and those who have illness in their heart, meaning by the illness in their faith, would say to those who believe, to the believers, look for us so we can have some of your light. Turn around, let your light illuminate our back. قِيلَ اَرْجِعُ وَرَاءَكُمْ فَالْتَمِسُ نُورًا. Go back to the dunya, if you can, to have some light with you. So you need to grab your light from here, because over there you wouldn't have an energizer to illuminate your way. You only have your deed in this life. So, اللهم اجعل في قلبي نورا وفي لساني نورا واجعل في سمعي نورا وفي بصري نورا واجعل من امامي نورا ومن فوقي نورا اللهم اجعل لي نورا. The nur here is the guide in the dunya and the light on the day of resurrection. What are the supplications that the Prophet ﷺ used to tell the companions and the Muslims to pray? اللهم إني أسألك بحق السائلين عليك وحق من شاي هذا فإني ما خرجت إشرا ولا بطرا ولا رياء ولا سمعة ما خرجت إلا اتقاء سخطك وابتغاء مرضاتك أسألك أن تنقذني من النار وتغفر لي ذنبي إنه لا يغفر الذنوب إلا الله. What does that mean? اللهم إني أسألك بحق ممشاي هذا. O my Lord, I'm asking you by the right of these steps that I'm taking to the masjid. وحق السائلين عليك, and the right that the people would ask you, have upon you. What is the right that any person can have upon Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? You don't have that. He is our Lord. But He made right for us. He subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَقَالَ رَبُّكُمُ ادْعُونِي أَسْتَجِبْ لَكُمْ. Your Lord says, call me, I'll answer you. Supplicate to me and I will answer you. And look for the word idruni astajib. The two words are very close succeeded words, successful. There is no intervening letter. He didn't say subhanahu wa ta'ala idruni sawfa astajib or idruni sa'astajib. Or idruni fa astajib, it's just idruni astajib. No intervening. And even Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala did not tell the Prophet to tell us so. It comes like that. In every question that came in the verses of the Quran, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَيَسْأَلُونَكَ. They ask you, O Muhammad. وَيَسْأَلُونَكَ عَنِ الْخَمْرِ وَالْمَيْسِرِ. They ask you, O Muhammad, about the wine and the gambling. قُلْ فِيهِمَا إِذْمٌ كَبِيرٌ. Say, they have a lot of sin. Okay? وَيَسْأَلُونَكَ عَنِ الْمَحِيرِ. They ask you, O Muhammad, about the menstruation. Say, it's an adha, it's a harm. فَاعْتَبِلُوا النِّذَاءَ فِي الْمَحِيرِ. Keep away from the woman during the time of the menses. So it comes, وَيَسْأَلُونَكَ. They ask you, and the answer, say. Say to them. Except in this verse. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَإِذَا سَأَلَكَ عِبَادِي عَنِّي. If my slaves ask you about me, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala speaking to the Prophet ﷺ, if my slaves ask you about me, you would expect the answer would be, قُلْ say, O Muhammad, as likewise as the other question. No, there is no قُلْ. The answer is direct. وَإِذَا سَأَلَكَ عِبَادِي عَنِّي فَإِنِّي قَرِيبٌ أُجِيبُ دَعْوَةَ الدَّاعِ إِذَا دَعَانِ. If my slaves ask you about me, I am close. I would answer whoever supplicates to me if he did. So there is no intervening between us and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, even the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Even in the answer of the question, فَإِنِّي قَرِيبٌ, I am close to them. So this is a great meaning that you can supplicate and pray to Allah at any time, at any moment, without the need for any intervening
person or something or whatever. You don't need to be in a place, you don't need to be in a situation, you don't need to be in a position, you don't need to be in a specific manner. You just pray for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You just supplicate to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So this is حق السائلين عليك, the right of those who are asking Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and their right is to be answered. And as we all know that the answer must not come immediately. The answer for your supplication can come in a way of three ways. Either it can come direct, you would ask to have an iPhone, and you would get an iPhone. So this is a direct answer. Or it can come by alleviating a tribulation or a disaster that you would have been afflicted with, which might not be related to your supplication, but it was removed by your supplication. Like you're asking for a wife and you would have catch a disease, and then you did not catch, you did not have your, the wife, but you're being cured from that disease. So that the meaning of the addu'a wal bala yatafara'an bayna as-sama'i wal ard. Supplication to Allah and the affliction by things that come down are in fight between the heaven and the earth. So things are coming upon you. Every person is subjected to things that he do not like or he does not like disease, poverty, whatever, love of. This is the life, c'est la vie. So this is the way that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala makes the life to be. Because if it is not so, it would be the paradise, and we wouldn't be eager to go to the paradise. So you might pray and supplicate for something to happen, and it wouldn't happen, but you've been protected from something that's even more. Okay. And that's why there's a very nice verse for one of the scholars who's called Ibn Qayyim rahimahullah, who say, لو علم العباد كيف يدبر الله لهم أمورهم لتقطعت قلوبهم وذابت من محبتهم لله سبحانه وتعالى. If the people only know how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is managing their own matters and lives, their hearts would gone into pieces and melted from the love to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for such caring and nourishing and cherishing them. But we don't know. We don't know what's going on in the destiny. But we can't trust that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wouldn't torture us or wouldn't harm us. Especially if we believe and go on the right way. مَا يَحَى اللَّهُ بِعَذَابِكُمْ إِنْ شَكَرْتُمْ وَآمَنْتُمْ. What Allah would do with punishing you or torturing you if you thank and believe in Him subhanahu wa ta'ala. So back to the hadith, اللهم إني أسألك لحق السائلين عليك. Oh my Lord, I'm asking you with the right of the people who ask you. وحقي أمشي هذا, and with the right of the steps and walking I'm walking in. فإني ما خرجت إشرا ولا بطرا. I did not go away out of my home إشرا ولا بطرا ولا رياء ولا سمعة. I did not go away just for showing people, or just to be for people to speak about me, or to gain popularity, or to make some fame that he is a good person, he's keeping the prayers in the masjid and so on. So I did not go for these intentions. ما خرجت إلا ابتغاء سخطك وابتغاء مرضاتك. I only get away of my bed and get away of my home to the masjid ابتغاء سخطك, to be away from your anger. وابتغاء مرضاتك, asking for your pleasure. أسألك, after that all I'm asking you, أن توقظني من النار, to save me from the hellfire, وأن تغفر لي ذنبي, and to forgive my sins, for there is no one forgiving the sins except you. So these are some of the supplications that a Muslim would do on his way to the masjid. And in such a way, you would only feel that you're preparing yourself for the next move. Just, you're not going to pray just like that. You wake up, or you left whatever you're doing, you make ablution in your home, then you go away to the masjid, supplicating to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, then you reach the door of the masjid where you do another supplication. By the door of the masjid you would enter with your right feet and you say Bismillah, Allahumma salli ala Muhammad, Allahumma aftah li abwaba rahmatik. In the name of Allah, May Allah have His blessing and peace upon Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. O Allah, open the doors of Your mercy for me. Allahumma aftah li abwaba rahmatik. And you say, أعوذ بالله العظيم وبوجهه القديم وبوجهه الكريم وسلطانه القديم من الشيطان الرجيم. I'm seeking the refuge by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, His faith subhanahu wa ta'ala, and His power subhanahu wa ta'ala from the shaitan. For that you're asking Allah for the mercy and you're making isti'adha from the shaitan. Then when you are in the masjid, as we mentioned earlier, whenever you are in the masjid, you are in the salah. Even if it's before the salah is to be made, the angels are kept praying upon the Muslim faith. Allahumma aghfir lahu, Allahumma arhamhu, may Allah forgive him, may Allah make mercy upon him. When you're going out of the masjid after finishing the salah, you would say Bismillah, Allahumma salli ala Muhammad, Allahumma aftah li abwaba rizqik. And this would show you how Islam is a complete life. It's not only praying. When you're going into the salah, you're asking for the mercy into the masjid. When you're coming out of the masjid, you're asking for the rizq. You're asking for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to give you from the bounty on this earth to give you any type of anything that we have in this life is a type of rizq. Your time is rizq. Your IQ, your mind is rizq. Your ability to remember is rizq. The money that you have is rizq. The car that you have is rizq. The daughters and the sons that you have are rizq. Everything is rizq. So you're asking Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to give you so. Okay? So whenever you're going to the masjid, you're asking for mercy, and you remember the day after. And whenever you're getting out of the masjid, you still asking for the rizq from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Because as we know, قُلْ إِنَّ صَلَاتِي وَنُسُكِي وَمَحْيَايَ وَمَمَاتِي لِلَّهِ رَبِّ الْعَالَمِينَ لَا شَرِيكَ لَهُ وَبِذَلِكَ أُمِرْتُ. Muhammad tells that my prayer and my nusuk, which is my slaughtering, like in Eid al-Adha, when you slaughter your animal. قُلْ إِنَّ صَلَاتِي وَنُسُكِي, my prayer and my slaughtering, my whole life and even my death, لِلَّهِ رَبِّ الْعَالَمِينَ, is only for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the Lord of the universe. لَا شَرِيكَ لَهُ, he has no associates with him, he has no partners with him subhanahu wa ta'ala. وَبِذَلِكَ أُمِرْتُ, this what I was ordered for. So your whole life in such a way. The next item is the excellence of proceeding to the masjid to attend salah. Abu Hurairah, may Allah be pleased with him, the companion of the Prophet ﷺ, reports that the Prophet ﷺ says, if anyone goes back and forth to the masjid to attend the prayer, Allah will prepare for him a feast in the paradise as often as he goes to them to back and forth. So when you move to the masjid back and forth, you will have in the paradise a place, a settlement, wherever you go back and forth. مَنْ غَدَى إِلَى الْمَسْجِدِ أَوْرَاحِ أَعَدَّ اللَّهُ لَهُ نُزُلًا فِي الْجَنَّةِ كُلَّمَا غَدَى أَوْرَاحِ. This is the Arabic translation of the hadith. Another hadith which is real good, glad tidings for those who keep the prayer in the masjid. Prophet ﷺ says, as reported by Abu Sa'id radiallahu anhu, if you see a man frequenting the mosque, then to testify that he has faith. As Allah says, the attendants of Allah's mosque are those who believe in Allah and the last day. إِنَّمَا يَعْمُرُ مَسَاجِدَ اللَّهِ مَنْ آمَنَ بِاللَّهِ وَالْيَوْمِ الْآخِرِ. The hadith says, إِذَا رَأَيْتُمُ الرَّجُلَ يَعْتَادَ الْمَسَاجِدَ فَاشْهَدُوا لَهُ بِالْإِيمَانِ. If you see the person of the man going to the masjid so frequent, يَعْتَاد, you know يَعْتَاد, in Arabic language you say تَعَوَّدَ أَوْ اِعْتَادَ أَوْ عَادَ. It comes from his getting manner to do this, so he's frequenting doing this. So if you see someone who is almost always, very frequently, going to pray in the masjid, you testify to him that he has faith. So the Allah, he has iman, because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, إِنَّمَا يَعْمُرُ مَسَاجِدَ اللَّهِ مَنْ آمَنَ بِاللَّهِ وَالْيَوْمِ الْآخِرِ. Those who attend to the mosque of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala are those who believe in Allah and in the last day of the day. Again, Muslim recalled on the authority of Abu Hurairah radiallahu anhu that the Messenger of Allah said, if anyone purifies himself in his house and then walks to the one of the houses of Allah to fulfill one of the obligations laid down by Allah, then each one of his steps will erase one of his sins, and the next will raise his degree. إحداها تحط خطيئة والأخرى ترفع درجة. One step would erase one of your sins, and who of us has no sins? We all have mistakes, and we need to erase this mistake, and we need that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala would forgive us, because at the end of the day, it's just the balance between the number of the good deeds and the number of the bad deeds, and the intensity of the good deeds and the intensity of the bad deeds. So you still need to erase this. You can erase these bad deeds by repentance to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, where you don't have to have any intervening person. You just go to Allah by repentance and by istighfar, asking Allah for forgiveness all the time. Astaghfirullah, astaghfirullah, astaghfirullah. I'm asking Allah for forgiveness. And by doing things that erase this deed, like remembrance of Allah, like walking to the masjid, like making charity money and الصدقة تطفئ الخطيئة كما تطفئ الماء النار. Alms and charity would put down the sin like the water would put down the fire. And by doing the good deed, إن الحسنات يذهبن السيئات, the good deed would wash away the bad deed. So these are the way that we can increase our balance on the day of resurrection. Again, Abu Darda reports the Messenger of Allah says, the masjid is the house of every wise person, and Allah provides everyone whose house is the masjid with comfort, pleasure, and a path to Allah's pleasure, to paradise. And this is related by At-Tabarani and Al-Bazzar rahimahumullah. Now we come to what you would do when you enter the masjid after saying the supplication of entering the masjid. What you would do, what you would do? Yes, what sunnah? Tahiyyatul masjid. You would pray two rak'ah, which is Tahiyyatul masjid. You would do that before sitting down. إِذَا دَقَلَ أَحَدُكُمُ الْمَسْجِدِ فَلْيُصَلِّي رَكْعَتَيْنِ قَبْلَ أَنْ يَسْجِدِ. If one of you enters to the masjid, let him pray two rak'ah before he sits down. So even if it is not the time of the obligatory prayer yet, and people are waiting for the salah, you don't sit. You have to pray two rak'ah as salutation for the masjid before you sit down. Okay? Then you can sit, you read Quran, make remembrance of Allah, or even just sit, doing nothing. Even if you sit doing nothing at that time, the angels are praying for you. Allahumma aghfir lahu, Allahumma arhamhu. Allahumma aghfir lahu, oh Lord, forgive him, oh Lord, bless him. Now we close tonight by what are the three most excellent mosques? What are those three mosques? Al-Masjid al-Haram, Al-Masjid al-Nabawi, and Al-Masjid al-Aqsa. Yes. Al-Masjid al-Haram, which is Al-Ka'ba, which is the Masjid of Mecca. Okay. And in the Hadith that Jabir reported, that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, may Allah have his blessing, peace upon him, faith, prayer is inviolable. Inviolable mosque is the Masjid al-Haram, because it's not to be violated by any means. So prayer in the inviolable mosque in Mecca is like 100,000 prayers elsewhere. And the prayer in my mosque in Medina is like 1,000 prayers elsewhere. And a prayer in Baytul Maqdis in Al-Quds, Jerusalem, is like 500 prayers elsewhere. صلاة في المسجد الحرام بمئة ألف صلاة فيما سواه وصلاة في مسجدي هذا بألف صلاة فيما سواه وصلاة في المسجد الأقصى بخمسمائة صلاة فيما سواه. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created everything. He created the earth and the places. He created the time and the month and the day. And He chosen some places to be of greatest value and of higher reward. And He chooses subhanahu wa ta'ala sometimes to be of greater value and of higher reward, like the time in Ramadan, like the time of Al-Hajj, the pilgrimage, like every night at the last third of the night, like the day of the Jum'ah, and so forth and so on. So the Muslims have to pick up this time and those places to multiply his reward. It's just the blessing of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. أَلَا وَإِنَّ لِلَّهِ فِي أَيَّامِ ذَهْرِكُمْ نَفَحَاتِ أَلَا فَتَعَرَّضُوا لَهَا. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala have blessings and mercy in the days of your time. Expose yourself to it. عَفَى أَن تُصِيبَكُمْ نَفْحَةٌ لَا تَشْقُوا بَعْدَهَا أَبَدًا. You might have one of these blessings subhanahu wa ta'ala at the time. You would pray, you would supplicate, and He would answer. And it's your winning time. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala accept our good deeds. نسأله سبحانه وتعالى أن ينفعنا وإياكم بما قلنا وسمعنا. أقول ما تسمعون وأستغفر الله عز وجل لي ولكم. وسبحانك اللهم وبحمدك. أشهد أن لا إله إلا أنت. أستغفرك وأتوب إليك. وجزاكم الله خيرا.